If you ask divers what their favorite course was, most, in my experience, will say it was rescue. Rescue also has a fair bit of variability that the instructor just can't expect. A lot of crazy, funny, scary things have happened over the years. And here, I'm going to outline a few of the memorable ones. All right, this one. I had this scenario where the rescue students were supposed to look out on this beach and see someone panicking at the surface way, you know, out there. Now, the person who was helping me was a real nice person and enthusiastic, almost too much so. In my mind, I think of this person as Flanders from The Simpsons. A combination between Flanders and a Boy Scout on steroids. Picture that. So I told this person, all right, I'd like you to go out there. There's this rope line that's about 25, 30 meters out there. I'd like you to be about 5 to 10 meters on the other side of that rope line. And that would be a depth of about 12 meters. So total, like whatever, 40 meters from shore. You know, at such and such a time, you know, if you could go panic diver, my students will see you come out, rescue at the surface, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, Flanders wanted to overachieve on this one. And, you know, I'm there doing my thing, and my rescue students look out there, and they're like, oh, there's somebody. And I look out there, and Flanders Scout is like 300 or 350 meters out in this bay. And I'm like, oh, no. There are a couple problems with that at this particular site. One problem is, once you get beyond a certain amount of distance out, the dive centers that were on the beach, they're not happy. Because you can start to interfere with boat traffic, or you know, they just start to think their responsibility immediately, man. My dive center, they're out there, they have glasses, they're calling other centers, looking out there, and I'm like, oh my gosh, they're talking to me. Hey, get him in here. How am I gonna get him in here? He's like 350 meters out there. So we say, well, the best way to get him out is rescue him, right? So the students start running and swimming and, you know, activate the imaginary medical service, you know, everything, right? They're going out there. Flanders Scout, he's out there and he's, you know, resisting arrest as I asked him to do. And then, as it turns out, they dropped his equipment and the equipment was not inflated enough and it went to the damn bottom. And out there, it's far, like I said, but the depth is still only about 21 meters deep. However, the visibility that weekend was like 3 meters or something. It was terrible visibility. So bottom line, the equipment was lost and we did not find it that day. Somebody found it the next day, and how they found it was there was a slight leak at the first stage and it left a bubble trail, and somebody found this bubble trail at the surface and followed it and found that equipment the next day. Otherwise, well, we would have found it. Someone would have found it on a good visibility day, but not that one. As most of you know, in a rescue course, there's always some sort of a search and recovery scenario. And that one, depending on the area and the dive site, can really have some mixed results. In one case, I was the victim being searched for and recovered, and I thought, oh, I'm gonna get all creative. And I was with a dive master, and I went and I tied myself with cave line to this chain, a really thick chain underwater. It was pretty shallow, maybe 10 meters. And I had the dive master there waiting with me as a safety thing, because he helped me tie myself up. It was really cold for me, and I was in a dry suit. And I waited, I can't remember, 30 or 40 minutes, and nobody was coming to find me.
I used to hide, and you never found me.
Did you know I never looked?
So I finally got too cold, and I just gave up, and I said, let's get out of here. My dive master cut me all out. And my fantastic plan to be discovered and the rescue students were gonna need to use their treasured cutting implement, which most people never get to use in our environment. That whole scenario was scrapped. And I don't remember what we did instead, but I was not waiting in the cold water alone. Another interesting one on the search and recovery. It was a big event. I had multiple leadership there that day. The dive group, maybe a couple of the students together, were supposed to search and rescue for another one of my dive leaders who was out waiting at, I don't know, maybe 12 meters on the bottom, out, you know the situation. And I'm on shore, so what I'll often do is, if I'm in that scenario where I have more than one person, when they surface, I will either be waiting on the surface or enter and observe the equipment off and help out with that as well. In this case, time is going by, and nobody's coming. Finally, the rescue students come back and they say, hey, we got there, we found the person. He didn't want to be rescued. And I said, what are you talking about? Get out there and rescue him. Don't take no for an answer. They went out, they came back like another 30, you know, the whole thing took like probably 60 minutes. And later on the debrief, I found out from the dive leader who was being rescued, he was like, oh yeah, well, I thought there were people from another dive group trying to rescue me and I didn't want to be bothered. I was like, no, I'm fine. I'm waiting for a rescue. So I sent them away. So he had rescue rejected, talked to the hand. It was a bizarre moment. All right, one time in Thailand, I was not associated with a rescue course. I was on a dive and I was with a buddy I didn't know very well. And the buddy, probably we weren't very close to each other. I was laying on my stomach. I was looking under this rocky overhang and there was some hermit crabs and they were fighting over this shell. And it was a totally fascinating moment for me. One hermit crab come over, pick up the hermit crab, pull him out of the shell, put his ugly ass in the shell, and start to run away. The other crab come, grab him, grab. It was back and forth. I was like, oh my gosh, man, this is, boom, totally engrossing me, oh my gosh. And so I'm watching this thing, and as I'm laying on my belly watching this, probably for some time, turns out I started getting rescued by a rescue student from another dive boat, saw me laying on the ground, probably thought I was from his or her course and just started rescuing me. So I'm getting manhandled, and I'm trying to, you know, fight this off. And the person was probably think I was a panic diver, so then started, you know, really going with it. So it was a very uncomfortable moment. Luckily, I was more powerful than that diver. I was able to create some space and say, hey, no, wait. And the person realized I wasn't from their boat. So I narrowly escaped being rescued. This one's a little bit gruesome. I have a picture. I'm not sure if I'm going to show it. I was running a rescue course. I was in the pool. I love pool rescue, that phase. Usually I have pool and I have open water. And in this pool, it's a deep pool, and there are a couple hazards here and there on the walls of the pool. I was doing some free diving in the 4-meter pool, and I was coming up, and I came up in a spot where there's a ladder sticking off the edge of the pool, and it's on the far side of the pool. It cracked me right in the head as I was coming up, and also compacted my vertebrae. This is a really bad situation for me, but I'm teaching the course. I have to shake it off. So I shake it off. I get up onto the side of the pool and I start talking. I think there were three students in the course. And I start talking to them. All right, next we're going to do this, this, and this. And they're looking at me. All of a sudden their eyes just got big as dinner plates. And it's like, what? I feel my face. There's all blood coming down off of my head from a split that I had in my head. And I must have seemed like the most badass instructor in the world, because I'm just bleeding and I'm just going teaching, you know, not noticing it. How would I notice, right? And I ended up, I had a couple more hours of teaching before I went and got it stapled after the course. But I, you know, someone had to teach the course. I waited until it stopped bleeding and then got in and did my thing. So, gotta be tough. The last incident was one that took years off my life. I had, it was a husband and a wife team. They did fantastic. They ended up going on to Dive Master. And on the rescue course, they had finished, completed, everything was satisfactory. And then they had said, is it okay? We'd like to do one more scenario just, on our own. I would like to practice XYZ technique. You know, it was surfacing someone large. And I was like, sure, go ahead. I'll wait here on the beach. You know, you guys are done. I'm, you know, doing other things, but I'll wait on the beach for the surfacing and watch the surface portion. And they were perhaps also with a dive master. So it was the couple and they were surfacing a large diver. They come up to the surface and I hear this screaming like the alien queen mother is bursting out of someone's body, kind of blood-curdling screaming. And the person doing the screaming is not the make-believe victim. It's the rescuer. So I know something's wrong. So I run over and I observe from a distance, all right, something's not right. This is not cool. And I see that there's no acting going on. I run and activate emergency services, because I didn't know what's going on. So, you know, emergency services, oxygen being run to the beach, a backboard, everything is happening. Now, this person now, she's being brought in by two people. So that's as fast as that's going to happen. And on the beach, there's no rowboats or anything like that. So in this case, the fastest thing was to wait for these folks to come in. And I was halfway out of my dry suit, so I could not jump in, actually. And I'm waiting and waiting. And if you saw my video that I released, actually, it was happens to be released today, but that 60 seconds, 60 of the longest seconds, I spent a couple of the longest minutes of my life waiting for this group to come in to find out what horror just happened to this person and what I'm going to be confronted with. And they got in, and what I found out was that the diver dislocated her arm and was screaming in pain, and she was in a dry suit, so really hard to manipulate it. And what I found out was this diver's arm actually dislocates occasionally, sometimes. That's an issue this diver has. And in the future, after that, it had happened once in a while in all different kinds of scenarios, including sleeping. So I ended up getting used to that. But if you're an instructor or a dive master, you know what I'm talking about. That time that you're waiting for something to resolve itself and the years of your life, like sand in an hourglass just dripping away. That was a tough one for me. All right, so if you have any stories of your rescue or other people's rescue, post them up. I know it's always an interesting course for folks. Thanks for listening to the stories. If you got something out of this, you enjoyed it, you got a chuckle, you got a laugh, give us a like. We're heading to 2,000 subs and beyond. You want to join that? Feed the algorithm. I will see you on the beach.